Hello everyone, this is CHM201, Physical Chemistry, post-quiz workshop lecture for 2020-2021 session. I'm Andrew Tehemi-Tiowua, I lecture Physical Chemistry in the Department of Chemistry, Benue State University, Makurdi, Nigeria. This lecture is meant for my second year chemistry students here at Benue State University, as well as other students worldwide who are interested in the videos I produce on this channel. If you've got any questions or any comments, I encourage you to send those to me using either my university email address or my Google email address. Alternatively, you can leave comments in the comment section of the video on YouTube and I'll do my best to respond. The first question says, why do gases deviate from their ideal behavior at high pressures and low temperatures? Gases deviate from their ideal behavior at high pressures and low temperatures because of the finite volume they occupy at these conditions. Remember, according to the kinetic theory of gases, gas molecules have no volumes of their own, as well as there is no intermolecular forces of attraction between the gas molecules. All of this, we have seen that real gases do liquefy or do solidify. That is to say that they do have real volume, as well as there are intermolecular forces of attraction between them. So at low pressures, the gas molecules are far apart and they occupy the volume of the container. As pressure increases, the distance between the gas molecules decreases. And as a result, the volume they occupy becomes significant compared with the volume of the container itself. Secondly, at high temperatures, the gas molecules have enough kinetic energy to overcome intermolecular attractive forces. When gas molecules collide at high temperatures, because they have enough kinetic energy, they are able to rebound. As temperature decreases, the magnitude of the intermolecular attractive forces increases. And as temperature decreases further, this magnitude of the intermolecular attractive forces becomes very high. And that is to say, the intermolecular attractive forces become strong enough to hold the gas molecules into a finite volume at low temperatures. The second question says, arrange the following gases in the order of increasing deviation from ideal behavior. And of course, this is with respect to the compressibility factor Z. So for gas A, we've got compressibility factor Z to be equal to 0.9, B 0.7, C 0.5, and D 0.3. What we know is that for ideal gases, the compressibility factor given by this mathematical expression is equal to 1. Therefore, the closer the compressibility factor of a gas is to 1, the less it deviates from ideal behavior. And the more it is away from 1, the more it deviates from the ideal behavior. So, gas A deviates less from the ideal behavior because its compressibility factor is closer to 1. Gas B deviates more than gas A. Gas C deviates more than gas B and A, and gas D deviates more than gas C, B, and A. That is, gas D deviates more from the ideal behavior than the rest of the gases. The third question says, write the van der Waals equation of state, which is as given, in terms of the constant A. If we begin with this mathematical expression and divide both sides by V bar minus B, we obtain this as the resultant mathematical expression. If we subtract P from both sides, we obtain this as the resultant mathematical expression. Finally, if we multiply both sides of the equation by V bar squared, then we obtain an expression with respect to the constant A as given here. The fourth question says, calculate the ratio of the most probable speed of nitrogen to that of oxygen at 25 degrees C. Nitrogen has molar mass of 14 grams per mole, while oxygen has a molar mass of 16 grams per mole. So we can write the most probable speed of nitrogen in terms of the most probable speed expression as shown here. And we can do the same thing for oxygen, where m sub nitrogen represents the mass of nitrogen gas, while m sub oxygen represents the mass of the oxygen gas. Kb is the Boltzmann's constant, T is the temperature. Of course, temperature is given there. If we divide the most probable speed of nitrogen by the most probable speed of oxygen, this is what we are going to have. We obtain this mathematical expression. And 2 kBT is there, and 2 kBT is here. They can cancel out. That leaves us with the square root of the mass of oxygen divided by the mass of nitrogen. To obtain the mass of nitrogen and the mass of oxygen, all we have to do is to divide the molar masses of the gases by the Avogadro's constant. When we do that and substitute into this mathematical expression, what we'll have is square root of 32 all over 28, which evaluates to approximately 1.1. The fifth question says, based on the variable equation of state, the compressibility factor of a gas is plotted against the inverse of its molar volume in figure 1. This is figure 1, of course. Using the graph, estimate the value of the second variable coefficient B. So this is a plot of compressibility factor against the inverse of molar volume. So this is the variable equation. Z equal to this expression, which is equal to 1 plus B all over V bar plus C all over V bar squared plus D all over V bar cubed, and so on. If we truncate this equation to the second term, that is, we ignore the third and fourth variable coefficient in higher orders, what we're going to have is this equal to 1 plus B all over V bar. If we make a plot of this, the compressibility factor, which is represented by pressure times the molar volume divided by the gas constant times temperature, we're going to have the intercept on the compressibility factor axis as 1, and we're going to have the slope as B, the second variable coefficient. So let's return to the plot. This is compressibility factor. This is inverse of molar volume. To obtain the gradient, or rather the slope of the graph, we draw a right angle triangle across the straight line, and then find values at the point where the triangle intercepts with the straight line. So for this case, this point here, what we've got is 0.4 times 10 to the power of 3 for the horizontal axis and 1 for the vertical axis. This way, we've got 11 times 10 to the power of 3 for the horizontal axis and 1.2 for the vertical axis. So we know that the slope is going to be equal to the change in the compressibility factor divided by the change in the inverse of molar volume. So if we substitute the values we've got from the graph where the triangle intercepts the straight line, what we are going to have is 1.2 minus 1 for the change in the compressibility factor, and 11 minus 0.4 times 10 to the power of 3 mole per meter cubed for the change in the inverse of molar volume. This evaluates to 1.9 times 10 to the power of negative 5 meter cubed per mole as the second variable coefficient. Yeah, so if you find this video helpful, I invite you to subscribe to my YouTube channel. Ring the bell so that when new videos are uploaded, you'll be notified. Like, comment, and share. Thanks for watching. The link to the PDF version of this lecture can be found in the video description. If you have any questions or any comments, I encourage you to send those to me using either my university email address or my Google email address. Alternatively, you can leave comments or questions in the comment section of the video on YouTube, and I'll do my best to respond. Bye now.